For the last 30 days, I ditched my iPhone to see if I could survive on an open source Graphene OS device. I wanted to find out how much convenience I'd have to sacrifice for extra security and privacy, and how difficult it would be to escape the Apple ecosystem. This is what I learned. And spoiler alert, there were a lot of hard lessons along the way. This video is brought to you by Proton Mail, the best in private and secure email. My name is Josh, and ever since I was detained and interrogated while living in China, I've been a bit paranoid about my privacy and security. I'm a big fan of end-to-end encryption, 2FA security keys, and freezing my credit, among many other things, but I'm not to the point where I've completely ditched all products from big tech companies like Google or Apple. Apple in particular has invested a lot of marketing dollars trying to convince us that it offers the most private phone on the market today. And honestly, I just prefer to believe them on that. But then you read stuff in the news about how they almost started scanning all user photos, or how they disabled encryption for users in the United Kingdom, and you just have to wonder what the future holds here.
As an alternative, the open source community has come up with some very interesting ways to flash existing phones. This is a Google Pixel phone running an Android operating system. Flashing it means replacing that Android operating system, or OS for short, with a different project that is more privacy and security focused.
There are some out-of-the-box solutions for this, such as the Above phone, which I've talked about before, but for this experiment, I decided to flash my own device to replace Google's Android system with Graphene OS, one of the most popular alternatives that I'm aware of. If you've never replaced an OS before, it can feel really scary. I mean, you just spent hundreds of dollars on a phone, and now you're about to lift the hood and mess with the code, potentially breaking this new device before you've even had a chance to use it. Thankfully, the instructions to flash Graphene OS are surprisingly well written and easy to follow. It took about an hour, but once I was finished, the phone now boots up without being connected to Google or Apple. Okay, so now that I have a working phone, that I've added a data-only eSIM, I'm gonna turn off my iPhone and see what happens. All right, let's start by comparing the initial setup. When you buy an iPhone off the shelf, you create an iCloud account and use the App Store to download trusted apps. Same with Google and the Google Play Store. But it's not quite as plug and play for an open source phone. First off, I had to learn that there are multiple app stores to choose from, like the F-Droid or Aurora stores. There are other app stores, but I'll focus on just these two as examples since they represent two very different approaches. F-Droid is an app store that only provides free and open source software, while the Aurora store is basically the Google Play Store, but you're able to download all of your favorite apps without being logged into a Google account. Of course, you could also just create a throwaway Google account and use that here as well. In other words, on Aurora, I can download Google Maps, but it won't be tied to my personal Google account. Whereas on F-Droid, I'm only able to download alternative map apps that are open source and privacy focused. On Aurora, I can download the actual Spotify app, whereas with F-Droid, I only have the option to download an open source alternative that offers more privacy, but maybe not as much functionality. There are pros and cons to both options, but my experience was a bit challenging. For example, since I can't use iMessage anymore, I decided to download Signal. But Signal only allows you to register a single mobile device. So that meant I either had to create a new account and reconnect with all of my contacts, or I had to deregister my iPhone in order to move that to the open source phone. And I honestly didn't really like either option. Another example was music. I tried to use the open source music app, but had so many authentication failures that I just gave up. Logging in on the actual Spotify app was as easy as you would expect, and I had music playing in less than a minute.
The one bright spot was Proton. Unlike all of these other apps, Proton Mail, Proton Pass, and the other Proton apps were all designed with a privacy-first approach, which means that installing and using Proton Mail on my open source phone was just as easy as doing so on my iPhone. My access to my private email was uninterrupted, and the end-to-end encryption is just as strong on Graphene OS as it is on iOS or Android. This is one of many reasons why I tell people to create a Proton account, even if you're never going to start using an open source phone. It's like taking small steps to hedge your bets against big tech, and it's your chance to take back control of your email from the hands of Google and Apple. It's better privacy, better encryption, and you can even get started for free. I appreciate Proton sponsoring this video and making it possible for us to test this mobile operating system, so go visit them at proton.me/allthingssecured.
Okay, So what did I like about using this open source phone? First, it was simple, clean, and fast. I've been told that GrapheneOS might have better battery life and performance than Android, simply because there aren't a lot of background tasks and connections to the Google servers being made. But I didn't personally notice anything. Battery life was good, performance was good. Overall, it just felt like the modern smartphone that it is. But then there's customization. There are a lot of ways to customize GrapheneOS to fit your risk profile. Maybe I'll do another video later to show various security and privacy settings I changed, but one of my favorite features is the ability to create different security profiles, which to be fair is kind of part of Android as well, although this is slightly better, but it's new for me as an iPhone user. So why is this useful? Well, over the past month, I've created my own sandboxes, which basically act like individual disconnected phones. They call these user profiles. So for example, I have one that holds any Google app that I feel like I really might need to use from time to time, but this user profile is completely isolated from my full privacy mode profile, which has absolutely no Google apps or connection to Google at all. I also decided to create another profile just to download and test apps that I may not trust yet, but I rarely use this at all. I experienced this isolation personally after having downloaded Proton Mail on both my private and my Google profiles. Since I'd already signed into my Proton account in the private profile, I incorrectly assumed that it would be signed in on all the profiles, but it's not. Each profile is treated kind of like its own device, and I have to sign in again if I still want to use Proton Mail, which I do. Apple doesn't have anything like this yet, and while Android has the option to create different users, the apps within each profile can still communicate with each other under certain conditions. It's not really a sandbox. With GrapheneOS, when I'm not using that Google profile with all the Google apps, Google can't see what I'm doing or track anything that's going on because it's on a separate, completely sandboxed profile. Most of this month, I've been using my full privacy mode profile, and while it does limit me, I can't easily check YouTube Studio, for example, and I don't have access to my messaging apps like Messenger and WhatsApp, this has naturally brought my screen time down quite a bit, which that's a good thing. Like most people, I'm pretty sure I'm addicted to my phone, and I think it's kind of cool that you can kill two birds with one stone, build better privacy, and curb my screen addiction at the same time. But if you think losing iMessage and FaceTime is bad, wait until you hear what happened with my mobile banking. So not everything has been nice and easy. One of the biggest downsides to using this GrapheneOS device is that I've lost access to any and all banking and payments. I mean, I can download the Chase Banking app or the Bangkok Bank app for here in Thailand, but they literally will not open for me. I got Venmo and PayPal to download and open, but I still couldn't use Tap to Pay or Scan to Pay where I'm at in Asia. And the only thing it was really good for was paying friends and family, which I don't do very often. I've read that there are other third-party apps you can install that offer a solution to this payment problem, but I decided not to go down that route since, frankly, a lot of them won't work while I live here overseas. This was one of the biggest reasons why I would have to take out my iPhone during the day, which I'll explain in a second. I live in a society that uses QR codes to pay for pretty much everything, and I can't use this privacy phone to do it. Another downside is the option of phones. The Google Pixel isn't bad, but for GrapheneOS, it's literally the only option you have. You can't flash a Samsung phone, a Motorola, a OnePlus, or definitely not an iPhone, just the Pixel phone. And when you flash this phone, you're basically erasing a number of key features that you paid for in the first place. The camera doesn't work quite as well without Google's software. Any Gemini AI features are gone, I can't use any voice assistant, and basically any benefit of integrating Google hardware and software is understandably gone. Now, I can bring some of that back by installing Google services, but that entirely defeats the purpose of using a privacy phone like this. So it's kind of this catch-22. Okay, I'm now deep into this month-long switch to using a GrapheneOS phone instead of my iPhone, and here's what I'm noticing. First, it wasn't as hard as I thought, although that whole payment thing is pretty annoying. What I end up having to do is keep my iPhone in my bag, turned off or maybe even in a Faraday sleeve, and then I keep the privacy phone in my pocket as the daily driver. However, it happens pretty much every day that I need to pull out and turn on this secondary iPhone to make some kind of payment, respond to my parents who still use iMessage and FaceTime, or take advantage of the nicer camera. Ironically, instead of paring down, using this new privacy phone is just added a new device to my daily carry. It's an additional monthly service payment, an additional bit of weight in my pocket, and something else I have to update and monitor. Based on what I've read from people using privacy phones, this is a pretty common dual phone setup. I'm not saying it's a bad thing per se, it's just an observation. All right, let's finish by summarizing my thoughts on this experience. First, it's gonna be a lot easier for an Android user to make the switch to an open source phone than for an iOS user like me to make that same switch. My learning curve was much steeper because I'm not used to the Android operating system, so everything on the screen and the gestures to use it felt very foreign to me. But perhaps surprisingly, it worked. It took time for me to find the right apps to use, and moving all of my messaging communication was clunky for sure, but since I already use Proton Mail and the entire suite of Proton's privacy apps, that was thankfully very plug and play. At the end of the day, everything about this process required a lot of intentionality. I had to intentionally spend that hour to flash the phone, make the choice of which app store to use, find the right privacy apps that fit my needs, and be intentional about using this phone instead of my iPhone. There are a ton of extra privacy and security features available to you with Graphene OS, but you really have to be motivated to use it. If you're still not sure, I get it. Or maybe you're hoping to move family members toward greater privacy. In both cases, I wouldn't really suggest a Graphene OS phone, at least not yet. Instead, you can take smaller, more manageable steps toward privacy, like creating a Proton account for secure email, calendar, cloud storage, and more. You don't have to jump straight into this privacy deep end. You can move there gradually with a free secure email account. Visit proton.me/allthingssecured to learn more.
Honestly, I'm still gonna use my iPhone, and I'm okay with that. But now I have a new tool in my privacy tool belt, and it's not as scary as it used to be.